I learned the word compositor recently, and I liked it a lot, so I thought, that's what I do. I make text into books these days. And then I thought about how, really, I've been composing for print much of my life. And like most of you, however, well, before I get into that, my table of contents is, I'm going to talk about before I saw the light and adopted tech. Then I'm going to talk about how and why I use LaTeX to write books these days. I'm going to skip a part of my printed paper, which is on editors, and then I'll have a little conclusion. As I was about to say, like many of you, I started my preparation for being a compositor with some very beginning tools. Right? I did images. I learned about bass lines, about extenders, descenders, and I had my big primary pencil. When I learned to type with two fingers as a child, I started doing it on my father's old Underwood typewriter from the 1930s or 40s. I'm not sure which.
That actually had a carriage return.
Yeah, it had a carriage return. And by the time I took my first typing course in high school, my only typing course, 2 days a week, one term, in high school, my father had a Royal manual typewriter, which had a two-color ribbon. You could either type in black or red. It was fantastic. Now, some of you will remember the tools we used back then to make a multi-element document. The fundamental thing was carbon paper. And how you did carbon paper, for those of you who are young, is you got a stack of paper, and you had some carbons and paper and carbon and paper. You lined it all up, you put it in your typewriter, and you typed something on it. You typed hard. You had to hit hard. The manual, you could control your hitting. Then it went through to the other pages. Now, of course, if you wanted to make a correction, you rolled the stuff out of the top, you found the first page, you got your little pink pearl eraser, and you erased that first letter. Then you move back a page.
You forgot to blow out the crumbs.
And you had to blow out the crumbs. And you did the next one. But remember, now you've got to put something under here so that you're not rubbing the eraser on the carbon paper. And you did that for all the pages. Right. Then you hit it really hard because there was no carbon left at that spot to try to get it to type again. Now, sometimes, because you hit it so hard, you couldn't get it out with an eraser, so the razor blade was the technique. You scrape the surface of the paper off. Okay, some of you will remember all of this. Now, the next thing I worked on was in my parents' church, they had a stencil machine on the left, or a mimeograph machine they were called, for making the Sunday church programs. And that's a device where you again hit something hard, the typewriter key breaks through the paper, and somehow a stenciling process works. I never quite understood that. However, the one I did understand quite well was the Ditto machine. My parents were both public school teachers, my mother elementary, my father high school, and they made Ditto masters for the class assignments and for the examinations and so on. And I looked around for... for the Ditto Master, the only editing tool was the razor blade. You really couldn't use an eraser there because you'd smear the ink. I looked around for a Ditto Master. I couldn't find one. So I made one by gluing a piece of carbon paper to a sheet of white paper and then taping another piece of paper to it. And the way this works is you write on this front page and the ink on the back of the front page that was adhered to the back goes through and makes something there. Then you tear this part off, you put this part in the Ditto machine, you spin it around with some Ditto fluid, and this little thing transfers onto the papers that go through. Now, it smelled great. I don't know what it was, ether or something, but it smelled great. Now, to fix that, you had to, you rolled it out of your typewriter when you made your mistake. You now had to separate the top to get in. This came with a little perforated part. You folded this back, and you got your razor blade out, and you scraped the ink off this page. Now, because that ink had already been used up on the back here, you had to get your scissors out, and you got a little piece of stuff, and you put it all, you kind of keep it all aligned, you put that right here, you rolled it back into the typewriter, you hit the key, then you took this little piece back out, and you went ahead. Okay, I can't tell you how many times I did help my parents with their various class assignments that way. I kind of enjoyed it. Now, the next thing I mentioned, I hadn't thought about this before, but for 4 summers, to pay my way through college from after high school, I worked on a Miele four-color lithograph machine in a big paper printing plant. Now, the part I did was not the sophisticated printing with registration and all that. I did the part where you stack the paper carefully at the back of the machine, and then you take the paper out of the front of the machine and stack it in places. It came out of the front of the machine in little piles so the ink wouldn't transfer, and then you put it in big piles for shipping away. Now, this was a very hot and sweaty job, and I assert it helped get me ready for working with LaTeX. The next thing that happened was I went to college, and in my junior or senior year in college, I got an SCM electric portable typewriter. And then when I went to work a couple of years later, the company had an IBM Selectric with the changeable type wall. Now, in that world, the correction techniques were Snowpake. You take the little stuff out, you draw it on the page, you blow on it until it gets dry, you hit it with the key, it turns out you didn't wait long enough, it smears around, now you get out your razor blade, then you repaint it, or CorrecType. And CorrecType came in little page, things like this that you tucked in, just like I did with that little piece of carbon paper in the Ditto Master, and you retyped it. Now, eventually, the IBM machine was neat. It had CorrecTape sort of built into it. So that was pretty wonderful. Okay. About this time, in 1962, I found computers. And I started using punch cards for very crude documents. You know, it just was what you typed on the punch card. Barbie, you're complaining about the model number of my punch card machine. You want it to be an 028 and not an 029 or something? Yeah, well, this is not actually the one I use, but it's the one I could sneak an image off the internet. Yeah. Then, by the time I graduated and from college and went to work in the computer industry, we had Model 33 teletypes with paper tape. So we saved our files on the paper tape. You had big rolls. We learned how to cut it and splice it. And then I got a Silent 700. A few years later from TI, noticed the acoustically coupled modem. Fantastic technology. Now, during the computer era, as I moved into the computer era, so did typesetting. And in fact, I used at MIT a little bit typeset and runoff, Jerry Salter's original, I think, typesetting programs that before anybody else. Then as my editor, I used Dan Murphy's TECO program on paper tapes. That's tape editor and corrector. That's the predecessor of Emacs. Richard Stallman and Guy Steele took a lot of the ideas from TECO and then implemented Emacs, with Stallman doing the bulk of the work eventually. But there's a wonderful story, if you have never read it, about Guy Steele and Stallman sitting together for the first 26-hour session while they coded Emacs. Okay. Then at BBN where I work, we had a version of runoff, which was a lot better, that a guy named Bernie Cosell implemented. And this went around the world on 10X, which was the good operating system in the early days of the ARPANET or internet. And one of the guys that worked with us was Rob Barnaby, who went off to be the coder for WordStar. And my belief has always been he took a lot of the ideas from runoff and put them into WordStar. Notice, these are all command-based typesetting languages or word processing languages. We all used them, as did all of our technical and non-technical typists. I assert that there's no reason anybody can't use command-based word processing, except that it's not what the person everybody else is doing. It's completely easy and everybody used to do it. During this after I used those kinds of tools for a while, I moved into the what you see is what you get world. I used Word for DOS, the very first DOS machine that came out, the very first IBM PC. It was a pretty nice program. Then I moved to Mac Word for a few years, quite a few years, because at that time Mac Word was ahead of PC Word. It was getting out better releases faster. They were still struggling in the PC world. Then I moved back to Word for Office and Windows, have used many, many versions there. And by the way, all the files that I saved for Word from DOS, I converted to Mac Word, wouldn't convert back to Word for Windows. Lots and lots of files. About this time, after quite a few years, maybe 8 or 10 years ago, I began to get frustrated with using Word. The reasons I got frustrated are listed here. There were data incompatibilities from release to release. The same files wouldn't work from one release to the next release. I just mentioned I lost access to a bunch of files. There were user interface incompatibilities. It worked different from one release to the next. And I got tired of finding the commands in the next version or figuring out how style sheets now work since they did away with the really nice way that used to exist in Word for DOS. Too menu-oriented. You have to keep hunting around for all these things in menus to do a cross-reference or whatever. And it's always guessing what I want to do. And I can't turn off enough things. I'm trying to turn off stuff. Don't do spelling checks. Don't do word extensions. Don't do anything, but it's always trying to do stuff. And it won't. You can't select the characters you want to edit because it decides, well, you really meant two more characters than that. Okay. So at that point, I switched to tech. It's about 8 years ago. I use Word every day, all the time. But I use tech for big documents or any document that I anticipate I'm going to want to reuse. And I switched to tech for these reasons. Well, let me step back a second. In fact, I've developed whole books in tech and then translated them to Word so that the compositor could have Word for input to Quark. That's another story, which is documented in a paper in Tugboat. The reason I switched to tech is listed here. It had a non-proprietary markup. It had a visible markup that was documented. But that seemed really good to me. Even if somebody went crazy and changed all of the way tech syntax looked, I could probably write a Perl program to convert my tech documents into something usable. Maybe it was another version of tech, but it was something I'd never be at the mercy of the proprietary, hidden, undocumented markup again. I was already familiar with command-based word processing, as I showed you. I've used a lot of it, so that didn't cause me any trouble. At the time, the people in my company were pushing FrameMaker, Interleaf, PageMaker, and so on, the technical documentation kind of people. But I didn't want to get involved in another proprietary religious war. And I'd always admired Knuth. So I thought, well, why don't I try this tech thing I've heard about? My tech evolution, my tech configuration evolved over time. I downloaded something I can't remember what off the internet. I tried it with Notepad. I quickly switched to LaTeX as soon as I discovered that there was something other than tech. I bought PC Tech. I tried it a while. I didn't like the editor. Too simple. The built-in, whatever you call it, IDE or something. I then found WinEdit, and then I found MicTech. I tried Y&Y tech, but I could never make it work, despite several phone calls back and forth to Carlisle. I eventually got VTech, bought that for HTML output in a couple of cases because it did HTML output really nicely compared with whatever else was available 5 or 6 years ago. And then last year I loaded ProTech with WinEdit and MicTech, and I still use that. I still use VTech a little. And today, this is my basic composition setup. I use Illustrator for a lot of images. I use Photoshop for manipulating images. I use Acrobat for viewing things. I use EPS to PDF to switch between EPS and PDF. And I use ProTeX and ProTeX, the WinEdit and the MixTeX. So, why and how I use LaTeX, particularly for writing books. The thing I like best about it is its programmability and modularity. Now, maybe because I'm a lifetime programmer, it all feels pretty good to me, but that's what I want most. I like the fact that I get to choose my own editor. I use WinEdit, which has regular expressions and so on. I use Emacs once in a while when the regular expression gets too complicated for me to figure out in WinEdit, and I can do it a little easier in Emacs. I like the explicit visible markup. It's got wonderful capabilities. Peter, where are you? Somebody yesterday was showing, Peter Flom was saying yesterday, wonderful capabilities, well, there you are, for cross-referencing, really easy to use. And I particularly like the slow pace of incompatible releases, unlike the fast pace of Word incompatible releases. You really never get too much as often in a situation where you send the file to somebody and they say, I can't read it, Word says it's garbled. Well, what does garbled mean? It means that I've got a different release than they've got, and they don't want to say the truth, which is they deliberately made it incompatible so somebody would have to buy a new copy. It's pretty nice that way. The typesetting itself is pretty nice. I like the way it looks without me having to do any work, but it doesn't matter that much to me. I don't have a discerning eye about typesetting, although Steve, Peter, wherever he is trying to teach me to have a better eye. And the math doesn't matter at all. I hardly write any math. I've written one mathy paper. In tech. Now, in my experience in writing a book or in writing anything, it's a very iterative process. The publishers don't tell you much until you really have the manuscript in hand. They don't want to waste their time on you 8 years in advance of you having the manuscript. So while they'll tell you some stuff, they really don't tell you much. But then they have a lot of ideas. In particular, the designers have a lot of ideas. I like to see a finished book sort of manuscript from the time I start typing the book because it gives me the false impression that I'm making progress. And that's motivational and keeps me writing. So even though I may have junk in the thing or stuff pasted from some other paper, I want it to look like a book. It really feels like I'm making good progress. And LaTeX helps me repeatedly change the way the book looks. As I evolve how I think about it, as I keep reorganizing it, as eventually I get it to the publisher and they begin to talk to me about how they want it to be, LaTeX lets me change it easily, and that's what I like. So I've evolved a set of techniques that I find useful. How are we doing on time?
20 minutes.
Good. Okay, we'll make it. I use include files, not input file, but include files. My preamble starts with my document class command. I'll get back to that in a second. Begin document, end document, with a bunch of include files in between. There's one include file for every piece of the paper, all the front matters together files, all the back matter, and all the chapters. Well, the current book I'm finishing has 10 chapters. The last one I did had 28 chapters. There's a chapter for each. Maybe there's sub-chapters inputted into the chapters, but the main chapters are all include files. That's pretty handy. I'll come back to the DT book class in a second. I use my own class file, and it turns out to be trivial, although I don't know what I'm doing. I just follow Carl's advice. Oh, the other thing that's neat is my editor, when I say, I don't know, I click some little icon, I never know what it means. Maybe it's kind of like a little tree in WinEdit. It makes a list of all the include files at the left-hand side, so I can just click on one of those and it opens in my screen. So I can move between the files for editing them by just clicking on this little set of bookmarks on the right side, on the left side. Very nice. Okay. Now, the other thing I have in my preamble, it turns out, before the document, begin document command, is a bunch of include onlys. Include only the preface. LaTeX only will compile the things you list in the include only parameter list. Include only surviving. Notice I have those two commented out. Include rapid. It's going to compile the chapter rapid. Include only surviving and rapid, those two chapters. Typically, I just keep adding them one after another. In the book I've just finished, I probably have 2 to 3 dozen lines of include only. Because I go back and reuse them, or I modify them, or I cut and paste and make another copy. I never delete them. But this is what's in my root file. My root file starts out with a document class. It starts out with some include onlys, all but one commented out. And then it's got a begin document, it's got all my include files, it's got an end document. I find that very convenient for working on the various sections of the book, compiling them separately, and so on. Now, remember it says here, document class, BT book. BT, by the way, stands for the book I just finished, which is on management breakthrough. So BT stands for breakthrough, my breakthrough book. This is the class for that book. Because it'll probably be a different class, augmented, improved, for the next book. Okay, Carl was telling me one day, you ought to have your own class file. You can get all that stuff that's in your preamble out of your preamble and put it off somewhere where it's all in one place. So I said, well, how do you do that? And he sent me these words. Okay, notice that I got to fill in that. And what I presume this does is somehow name a book class so that it gets recognized when the file gets loaded. The file name is btbook.class, so that gets found when it says document class, and apparently it's built on the book class. I'm augmenting that. It loads the book class. Well, this is pretty neat. Peter, you were saying this morning, how do I do a class file? I guess the other Peter's going to tell us tomorrow how to do it, but it seemed pretty easy to me once Carl gave me these three lines. Huh?
We need space between date and description. Doesn't matter to him.
I don't know. This seems to work.
The scary thing is I don't know what I'm doing either, and I just copied that from book CLS or something.
Now, the next thing that... Oh, now, there's a very handy thing about having all this stuff in the book class off there, BT book class. First, you don't have to include the name of your own definition file in the include only. If I had it all in a point tech file, every one of my include onlys would have to have Dave's macro file in it. This way, it comes automatically, and I don't have to have that in all my include onlys. The other thing is, I don't know why this is, but if I put stuff in the preamble where you have to mess with at signs, you have to make letter at and make letter unat. But if you do it off in the class file, you don't have to do that. So you don't have to bother with that. Somehow that's as if it's in the basic class. So that's pretty handy. So you can forget all about messing with any of your at stuff. I mean, your at stuff has to be off in the document class. So the next thing I have in my class file is a bunch of packages. Palatino is MathPazzo. Helvetica, scaled a little bit because somebody in some book told me that was a good idea. Courier for my typewriter font. Graphics, URL. Somebody told me recently, stop using use package and use require package because require package checks if it's already been loaded and doesn't load it again, and some packages break when stuff gets loaded a second time. So I'm doing what they tell me. I sometimes have full page figures, so I load the rotating stuff that lets me have a full page figure rotated. Lettering lets me have drop caps. I don't like the spacing of LaTeX basic lists, so I use ParList, which is compact item, compact enum, compact description, and I set the spacing with that command. I want the comment package, so I can say begin comment, end comment, comment out a whole bunch of text. I'll come back to this in a minute. I've modified the EndNotes package a little bit, so I called it DW EndNotes, so there'd be no confusion. Set space is a package which, if I take this little percent sign off, double spaces everything. If I leave it on, it's single spaces. I typically compose using single space. When I send it to the copy editor wants double space. So I comment out this, and it's ready to reprint, and it's ready to go to the editor. Geometry to set up my paper, to fit what the printer told me he wanted. Okay? Oh, by the way, in the paper version of the text of the file that you have, this command is before this one. I was trying to get it in one column. I moved it on top. It should obviously be after, not on top. The next thing you have in my class file is a bunch of miscellaneous useful macros. Dash. I always use dash, D-A-S-H, instead of three lines. And you call that as like this, some letters, a dash with no spaces, some things to end the command, and some more letters. For instance, if I had dash right here in the quick brown fox jumped over a lazy dog, I'd have these two little thin spaces around my dash. Now, sometimes when you get to the designer says, no, we don't want any spaces. So in that case, I would comment that one out, I'd uncomment that one, and now I've got no spaces. Or they say, no, we want full spaces, like this. So I leave this one commented out, and I comment that one, and I in-comment that one. Okay, so this lets, and furthermore, lets me change it back and forth if I want to see how it works one way. So I tend to have these in my little package. Now, for the book I recently finished, it was being set in 12 point, a minion, and I didn't like the way URL was showing stuff. So I made it smaller. And the way I made it smaller is I saved the original definition of URL here, and then I defined a new URL which changed the font size and then called the old URL. Okay, I used def here rather than new command because I wasn't sure what happened when I was doing this, and I was pretty sure this would work. I'm pretty sure probably new command would work as well. A couple of other ones, three others that I find pretty useful. I've got one called MA note, marginal note. These are notes I write to myself. So any place in my text, it may say / MA note, squiggly bracket, check this out, or talk to the co-author or something. So for instance, if right here I had MA note in the input file and a little bit of text, it would come out right there in the margin. Another one I have is CK, which I guess is kind of classic in proofreading for check. And so if I had right here where this CK came out in the output, I had right there / CK, that's what I'd get out. So I put these all over my document to mark up the places I want to go check. And this par title thing, I use a lot of cut-in titles. So I've defined it, and it's pretty straightforward. It does a little bit of a skip. It doesn't indent. It makes it bold. So if I just put / par title in the input text, I get this out. So in some documents, I have a lot more of these little miscellaneous ones, but that's ones that I happen to like quite a lot. Thank you, Klaus. The next thing I'll do is I'll talk briefly about footnotes and endnotes. When I compose, I like the footnotes at the bottom of the page because I can see them next to the text. Inevitably, when I get to the publisher doesn't want the footnotes at the bottom of the page because they think it makes the book look too scholarly and therefore unsellable. So, at that point, normally I would run with this commented out. So I had footnotes. I never use footnotes and endnotes at the same time, so that's not a problem. Now when it's time to go to the publisher, I erase that, and suddenly I'm using endnotes. And I've defined this little command called dump endnotes, which formats them a little bit the way I want them. Calls the command which actually puts the endnotes in the document, and then sets the counter back to 0 for the next chapter. And I put this little set of stuff at the end of each chapter. I put this command, dump endnotes, at the end of each chapter. Sometimes embedded in another command, which is all the end of chapter stuff. Okay? Formatting figures and tables. I patched LaTeX to change the figure and table caption format. That's not spelled right, that's caption format, rather than trying to find a package to do it. When I first wanted to do that a number of years ago, I sent a message out to compdeck.text.tech, and in fact, Peter Flynn sent me back the answer. And I've been using it ever since. Since then, I've discovered there are packages for changing the caption, but this works, so I don't change. And so that's in my printed paper. You can go look at that little piece of code I got from Peter. That's why I changed that's not the right. The next thing I've done is I've developed four or five macros for inserting figures and tables. This is primarily to allow me to change all the figures. I tend to have lots of figures and tables. Had probably over 300 in the book before this last one. I've got over 100 in the last one. And I inevitably want to change the format of all of them many times. So I do all of my figure calls in macros, which have a different name than, I never put begin figure, end figure in the actual text. I always put a figure here call. And I'll show you what that's about. You might ask, well, why do I change them? Well, I want them one way as the writer. The copy editor wants them another way. The copy editor wants the figures all on their own pages. Maybe with the captions on the same page, maybe with the captions in the text. Printer wants them another way. The sample chapter on the net maybe wants it another way. So I'm always changing all the figure captions. In the upcoming issue of the PracTech Journal, Will Robertson's going to have an article where, among other things, he deprecates this use I have of having not just putting begin and end in the text. But it works for me. So what are those changes I've made? Well, first thing, before I get into that, the defaults of LaTeX for where it will allow you to put a float are always putting things off at the end of the chapter. So I've changed those to allow bigger things on the page. That's what these first set of stuff is. The next thing I've done is defined a command called figure file type. And I change this from PDF to EPS or whatever, depending on if I'm using PDF tech or if I'm using LaTeX. So I can just change all those by changing this one line. I've got another little command called display file name, which either does something or does nothing, depending on which one of these I've got commented in and out, that lets me, and I'll show you this in a second, either display some stuff with the figures or not display some stuff with the figures. So here's an example. This is a slightly different than the standard figure caption. I think they're not bold. I think they maybe don't have the period. I think they may not have the dash. They may have a point or something. This is the way I've modified it. And that thing I was just showing you on the previous page at the bottom puts out for me the figure name, the name of the file, plus, in fact, the way it was written there, it puts a scale factor out here so I can see it. So when I'm proofreading the book and I want to know which figure I have to go change, I don't have to go back to my LaTeX file to figure out what the file is. I can't number them by chapters like the publisher, chapters and numbers within chapters like the publishers do, because I'm changing them around all the time. And so I just see the file name, and I can go load that file into Illustrator. I can modify that file, and I can save that file again. That's why I like this. Now, when I send this to the copy editor doesn't want to see that. So that's one of the reasons for turning this off. And of course, when the book is printed, you don't want to see that. So I've defined this thing. This is one of my many. Scaled numbered figure. It's got three arguments. Begin figure. I could say centering here, but I didn't know how to do that. So I put H fills around it. Include the graphics in a scale box. The third argument is how much to scale it. The second argument is the file name. This little thing is the extension of the file name. Remember, I defined it to be PDF or EPS. The caption comes from my call. The first argument of my call to SN figure is the caption. There's a label, which is named fig colon, and the file name. This is the little part that either displays the file name. This is different than it used to be. This should be DFN for consistency. And so I would access, I would define the figure like this, and I'd access it like that. Okay? I only have 5 minutes, so I will just mention that I use thought breaks, little things where you have extra little spacing, like right here. I have a whole bunch of those. Most of them are commented out. The one I happen to want to use for this style is here. I sort of have been collecting thought break indicators. Headers and footers. I use fancy HDR, but I haven't ever converted from using the fancy header parameters. Fortunately, they made it backward compatible. You can see that in the text of my paper. I put stuff like this at the beginning of each chapter, oftentimes in its own macro, which I'll define, which is begin chapter stuff with several arguments, and then end chapter stuff with several arguments. So again, I can change something one place, and I can change the way the chapter headings work. So that's basically the kinds of things I do so that I can modify the file many different times on the way to getting the book on the many times on the way to getting it composed. Why not use a fully developed class? Well, I didn't know them, but probably next time I'll try one. I can only try a new thing between projects, because you're always working on the deadline. You can't learn enough. Okay, last point. A couple of concluding remarks. My belief, and I've tried to hint at that with my first little things with the razor blades and all that, is everything involved in publication is a hassle. You can't avoid it. This is my conservation of hassle principle. The only thing you can do is try to be more productive in dealing with the hassle. And that's what the stuff I've just been showing you does for me. I don't argue it's best. I don't argue it's for you. But for me, it helps me deal with the hassle that just keeps happening and keeps happening. I've just got to keep changing everything. Somebody in the back of the room this morning was saying, well, wait till the person does efficiency until they find the need. I have the need. I have to do things that will let me make changes without having to do just massive searches that are they're not going to be the same. The next is sort of off the subject, but this is the point that, well, LaTeX is hard to use. For me, it's much more productive, but I'm a little bit unusual. You know, I've spent my life in computers. As I tried to argue already, everybody used to use command-based word processors. And I argue that it's no harder to use than any other significant thing we try to do in our lives. It all has to do with do you want to or not. It's no harder than learning to garden, grow stuff without killing it. It's no harder than sailing a boat. It's no harder than you learning to the rules of baseball. It's no harder than learning to use Microsoft Word in anything other than a completely crude way. The only question is, do you want to? And of course, that is affected by what everybody else is doing. And so that brings me to the last point, which is ubiquity. Word is everywhere. What we can do in our LaTeX world is have virtual ubiquity. Those few of us in the world at large that use it have to be in communication with each other. And that's why comp.text.tech is good. That's why Tech Hacks is good. That's why conferences like this is good. That's why the personal networking that begins to develop at conferences like this is good. We have to have virtual ubiquity so that I can, in effect, walk into the virtual next office and say, Kaveh, you know, what do you do in this particular case? Because otherwise, people aren't going to want to do it. The next step in my process of getting this book to the printer, which is actually doing the final layout to be printed, I did that, will be in my upcoming column in the PracTex Journal that it comes out sometime in August. I urge you to read it. And thank you very much for your engagement and attention. Do I have a minute for any questions or not?
Yeah, sure. Yes, just very quick comment.
Yeah.
If you look at slide number 3 of your figures, figures number 3, there is a figure type command which is EPS or PDF or something
depending.
Yeah, yeah.
The dirty little secret is
yeah.
you don't need this.
Okay.
If you just put a file name without extension and without a dot,
uh-huh.
the system will find the file you need, and depending whether it's PDF tag or LaTeX, it will actually select the proper extension for the file.
So the key is
just to put include
that
graphics number
right
two.
Here I have to delete that.
Yes, and it will do.
And then I can erase this.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thanks.
And that's great.
One more
I've improved my personal class file. Yes?
You might want to have a look at the package set files. And that's for institutional files. So you don't need, they can be, those included files, the set files could be transferred on their own without necessarily having to do it. I just saw that you're using the include mechanisms comprehensively.
I don't know how it is with the thing you're describing. One of the things that's nice about include files is if I compile all the chapters and then just do an include file, it's still remembering all the cross-references to places
mm-hmm.
that I'm not compiling right now. I don't.
And
sometimes you have to get rid of that.
Unless something changes between the runs,
yeah.
which sometimes happens.
Yeah.